Welcome, friends, to CNS series of interviews from the Breaking Ground, Taking Roots, this potentially game-changing meeting of hundreds of civil society champions from around the world, along with some government representatives, among others, happened recently in the Land of Smiles, the Thailand. This episode features a special conversation with two senior government leaders, Her Excellency Judy Taguivalo, Minister of Social Welfare and Development from Philippines, and His Excellency Brendan Rogers, Ambassador of Ireland to Thailand. Both of them were in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. Without any further ado, let's listen to Her Excellency Judy Taguivalo, Minister of Social Welfare and Development, Philippines, and His Excellency Brendan Rogers, Ambassador of Ireland to Thailand.
Why is it important for your government and other governments to develop CSO spaces for achieving Agenda 2030?
Well, firstly, government represent the people, and they should be working for the people. And civil society organizations are the people, and hopefully they represent the people. So it's the government's responsibility to work for the people, with the people. And civil society organizations and non-governmental organizations are the platform, the communicators, through which the people can speak to the government. An election is important. Elections, elect a government. But the process of communication, the democratic process, does not stop at that point. It continues with the partnership between the people and those who govern them, with their permission. So it is absolutely essential that the space is created for that dialogue. And that's why, you know, the Government of Ireland supports non-governmental organisations, community-based organisations and grassroots organisations in our objective of reducing poverty and bringing about the Sustainable Development Goals.
Yes, sorry. So, again, I agree with Ambassador Rogers. Civil society organisations play an important role in ensuring that the issues of the grassroots, of the communities, are brought to the attention of government. And government, if it is sincere in its role as providing services and serving the people, then should acknowledge the role and the recommendations of the civil society organization. In the Philippines, it is already enshrined in our constitution. The civil society organization play a major role in the democratization of society.
What have been the challenges in developing CSO spaces over the last 7 years, and how do we overcome them?
Well, the first government, the things that government faces to share their power with other organizations and to be inclusive. Because there is a tendency of all power structures to believe that we know best. So that is always a challenge for government. But government also have challenges to ensure that the people that they are speaking to, the civil society organizations that they are speaking to, truly represent the people as well. Government have challenges, government have responsibilities, but they are if they are democratic, they are the legitimate guardians of the countries. And they have to know that the people who come before them and say, we represent the people, genuinely do that, of course. So that is it is government's responsibility to ensure that they are very inclusive and that the organizations that they support and work with are also inclusive. That's a challenge for both sides.
That's right. Again, Ambassador. So I think civil society organizations have a major role to play in governance. And the challenge is really ensuring that the civil society organizations are legitimate and are not really representatives of just a small group. Okay. Two, on the part of the government, and it is our experience, to make the accreditation, because that's how you ensure legitimacy, that you have an accreditation process to sift the legitimate ones from the non-legitimate ones. But the chance for government is to make the process simple, not too bureaucratic, not too expensive, because there are genuine civil society organizations who don't have the money to pay for the requirements but are really good ones. So that's one of the steps I have taken in my department to make the accreditation process of CSOs simpler and less expensive.
The minister said a very interesting thing when she was on stage. She said we must speak truth to power. Civil society must speak truth to the power of government. But also within civil society, the membership must speak truth to the structure of power within the civil society organization, within the non-governmental organization, because power exists everywhere.
How can the Istanbul principles be useful in helping governments and CSOs as development actors to be more effective in achieving Agenda 2030?
Definitely. I think international agreements, international principles, international agreements provide a mandate at the national level. So in that sense, the Istanbul principles will help the civil society organizations and government, you know, improve their efficacy, improve their relationship, and eventually this would redound to better services to our people.
I fully agree with what the Secretary Minister is saying there. The principles are there, the mandate is there, the structure is there. The challenge is now implementing those principles. Because I've been at the UN and listened to ministers say something and then gone back to a particular country and it doesn't seem to be happening. But it's 4,000 miles away or 8,000 miles away. But the principles are there, we've all signed up to them, and that's why monitoring and evaluation and being held to account is so important. This is what you signed up to. These are the principles you signed up to, the Istanbul principles. Now, are you doing that in the capital A or capital B? And that's for Ireland as well as everybody else. Yeah, it's for each of us, because it's a universal. These things are universal. The SDGs are universal.
Is civil society space shrinking? And if yes, how can Istanbul principles be useful in helping safeguard the CSO space?
Well, look, we live in difficult times and there's a general consensus that CSO space is shrinking. And that is possibly true. But now, when I worked in development many years ago, there was very few CSOs and there was intimidatory governments in some of the places that I worked. That has all changed now. There's been a democratic revolution in the 90s and in the early 2000s throughout many continents. But what is happening is now, I think with the security agenda, there is a push back, governments are pushing back, they're saying CBOs are being funded from the outside, there are human rights issues, there are environmental issues, so there's no doubt that there is a battle there. And the question is, how can civil society, and that is, civil society, by the way, is a name for the people, right? Yes. Let's be clear, this is the people. So the people need to push back and they need to do it in the best way possible and they have to be united. You know, united we stand, divided we fall. And those of us who have the luxury of living in democratic states and democratic governments and who are members of international organizations like the United Nations or the EU, it's incumbent upon us to speak out and to push at international fora and in dialogue to ensure that we support the importance of a space for civil society.
Okay, that's right. I think the growth or reduction of the number of civil society organizations is a function of the governance in a specific society. So under democratic regime, then the conditions are better for civil society organizations to thrive. Under conditions of dictatorship, then freedom of assembly, freedom of association are prohibited, you know. I think in some areas, civil society organizations are thriving, in others, they are not. But the important thing at the end of my day, I think I believe in, you know, in the saying, where there is oppression, there is resistance. So if the conditions are terrible, the people will find a way of forming organizations, of forming associations, of acting so that their grievances are redressed, their rights are implemented.
And the minister has personal experience of this.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I think we've gone through, I was part of the anti-dictatorship during the Marcos years, so I was arrested, I suffered torture, I was forced to sit on a block of ice naked while being interrogated, and I was in prison first time for 2 years, 1 year and 7 months, then we escaped from prison, And then I went back underground, and I was rearrested. At the time I was rearrested, I was pregnant. So I delivered my baby inside the prison camp. But you know what the ambassador said, so long as you retain your commitment, your belief in the people, your belief in a better way of life, and your passion to serve, then you'll never grow old.
Congratulations.
Yes. Of course, having seen the other side of the fence also, oh, and that's important. Thank you so much.
We were listening to Her Excellency Judy Tagoiwalo, Minister of Social Welfare and Development in Philippines, and His Excellency Brendan Rogers, Ambassador of Ireland to Thailand. They both were in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. For more details, be welcome to check out CSO Partnership for Development Effectiveness or CPDE's website at www.csopartnership.org, or visit us at CNS. Website is www.citizen-news.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned.